Hey guys, you're listening to the Time of Football podcast, and this is our analysis of the NFC South prior to the 2018 NFL season. Hola, ¿cómo estás, everyone? Whoopity scoop whoop poop. Thank you guys for joining us on this for this podcast. My name is Hassan Khan. I am the founder of Time to Football. Usually for these podcasts, we have guests joining us. For this episode, it's just going to be me solo. So if you guys are thinking about shutting off this podcast, do it now. It would hurt my feelings, but do it now. But no, we'll get guests on in the future. We've actually got a couple of guests lined up already for future episodes later this month and going into next month as well. So if you guys are watching or listening to this podcast on YouTube, just know that I have a podcast on iTunes. The only reason I put it up on YouTube is because some of you subscribers on here on YouTube don't know that I have a podcast on iTunes. If you just go to the podcast app, search for Time to Football, it might be a little bit easier to listen to it that way. You can listen to it on the car ride to work. What I do is I put my headphones in and I listen to podcasts when I'm at the gym. Makes things a little bit easier than that. But we're going to be doing YouTube content as on top of podcasts on iTunes as well. But yeah, it's the month of May, so nothing much is going on. It's past the draft. If you had a chance to listen to our previous podcast, it was the second podcast that we came out with. It was me sitting down with Michael. If you're a fan of Town of Football, you know that he's in the Madden tournament. And we just talked about the NFL draft and which teams had a successful draft and which teams could have drafted a little bit better. But if you want to listen to that, go ahead and go an episode back. But this episode is actually our third podcast that we're doing. You're actually joining us for the first ever third podcast in Time of Football history. Isn't that amazing? It's wonderful. So what we're going to get into is we're going to talk about the NFC South. And going on in the future, you'll see eight different podcasts that are dedicated to each division in football. And we're going to give an analysis and a breakdown of each team in that specific division. And today we're going to talk about the NFC South. We got the Falcons, the Panthers, the Buccaneers, and the Jaguars. Just kidding. I was testing you. It's the New Orleans Saints. I'm reading my phone right now, actually, because we have if you don't know already, we have an Instagram for Time to Football. If you just go to Instagram, search Time to Football, you'll find us. I uploaded a video talking about Trevor Lawrence. If you guys don't know who he is, he's actually the hot prospect that was compared to Justin Fields as who is the number one quarterback in the country for high school football. And Trevor Lawrence, he's from around here, meaning that we film or Town of Football is based out of Georgia. And Trevor Lawrence is from Cartersville, Georgia. So I've been a fan of him. I've watched him play his whole entire senior year. I'm a big fan of him. And he committed recently to Clemson, so he's going to be playing there in 2018. But anyways, the video that I just posted about Trevor Lawrence was just talking about, hey, how do you think he's going to do? Is it going to be a future NFL star? Man, these guys are just laying into him about his looks. One guy said cut his hair. Another guy said, hold on, let me find this. Let me get this. Dude looks like a effing mongoloid named Mongo. Avatar dummy face looking donkey. The word wasn't donkey, but yeah, all I'm wanting is your opinion. Do you think he's a future NFL star or not? I guess he does need to cut his hair, but I mean, what does that say about me? Because I have long hair as well, but I'm keeping mine. So anyways, we're going to get into the NFC South and talk a little bit about that. So First team that I want to actually break down are the Atlanta Falcons, because we're talking about Georgia. We're talking about quarterbacks from Georgia. So let's talk about a quarterback that plays in Georgia for their professional football team, and that is Matt Ryan. Now, recently, Matt Ryan, the biggest news for him is that he signed a five-year, $150 million contract extension. Now, if you ask the question, is he worth that much money? You're going to get a various amount of responses. And all I can say to that question, my answer to that question is yes and no. People will say that Matt Ryan is not worth that much money because he's not the best quarterback. Well, no duh. He's not the best quarterback. Everyone knows that. Even Matt Ryan, I bet you, knows that he's not the best quarterback in the NFL. The Falcons know he's not the best quarterback in the NFL. It's Tom Brady. It's Aaron Rodgers, Drew Brees. Better than Matt Ryan. And if you disagree with that, I would love to talk to you about it. I would love to have a healthy debate without any rude comments. But there are so many other quarterbacks that are better than Matt Ryan. Man, dare I say it, even all around, maybe even Russell Wilson is better than Matt Ryan. But why did he get that $150 million contract extension then if he's not the best quarterback? Well, man, that's just the way the market works. A couple years ago, it was Derek Carr that was the highest paid quarterback. Then it was Matthew Stafford that was the highest paid quarterback. Then it was Jimmy Garoppolo that was the highest paid quarterback. Obviously, all three of those guys, which I think they're good quarterbacks, they're not better than Tom Brady or Aaron Rodgers, who are making less money. But it's just the way the market is. The Atlanta Falcons, think of this, you're in the shoes of Thomas Dimitroff and Arthur Blank and Dan Quinn. You're like, okay, Matt, your contract's coming up. I need to re-sign you because you've helped out our team a lot. You're a great quarterback. You're not the best out there, but you're all that we've got. You know, we could draft a quarterback, but it's going to take years to develop this guy. And right now, we're in that mentality. We're in that win-now mentality where we can still go after a Super Bowl. We went 10-6 last year. We made it to the divisional round of the playoffs. Our defense is getting better. Our offense is going to be more in sync with Steve Sarkisian. Matt, we need you. And Matt's like, okay, well, Matt Ryan's agent, let's say for instance, his mentality is, okay, you need us. You need us, so you have to offer us the most amount of money. And that's exactly what the Falcons did. It's not that he's the best quarterback. We can all agree on that. He's not. But he's the best that they got. So that's why they offer him that much money. I didn't mention Steve Sarkisian, and he's going into his second year. Last year seemed like it was pretty bad. And there were moments that were, but overall they did, as far in the passing game, they were ranked 8th in the NFL, believe it or not. They were a top 10 offense in the passing game. The run game was 13th, so it was better. It was better compared to when Kyle Shanahan was there. But Steve Sarkisian, is he going to be more in sync with the Atlanta Falcons offense this year? You know, they're at the lowest of lows, I think, so there's no way to go but up. And I believe that is going to happen. Steve Sarkisian is going to be more in sync. And there's an interesting stat, or I did a little bit of research on this. Kyle Shanahan, his first year in Atlanta was 2015. Okay, the Falcons went, I believe it was 6-10 or 7-9, something like that. But in 2015, in Shanahan's first year, the Falcons were 7th in the NFL in yards a game and averaged 21 points a game. In 2017, which was Steve Sarkisian's first year, so we talked about Shanahan's first year. This is Steve Sarkisian's first year. Last year, the Falcons were 8th in yards a game, and they averaged 22 points a game. So, relatively the same. But, in Kyle Shanahan's second year in Atlanta, in 2016, we all know what happened. He produced the 4th best offense in NFL history. Not in the NFL that year, but in NFL history. So, In his second year, can Steve Sarkisian, now that he's a little bit more in sync, produce the same amount of results? You guys probably are going to flip out. I'm not saying he's the next Kyle Shanahan. I'm just saying it's an interesting outlook on things, because in Shanahan's first year, they weren't in sync. They averaged less points a game than they did back in 2017, back last year, in Steve Sarkisian's first year. But in the second year, with Calvin Ridley dropping to them, with Tevin Coleman in a contract year, because players ball out in their contract year. Matt Ryan more in sync. Hopefully Julio Jones can stay healthy for a whole year. Are they going to be back to that same level? Maybe not as good or as historic as they were in 2016, but at least have the contention to where they went 10-6 last year with an out-of-sync offense. What can they do this upcoming year? Can they get past the division round of the playoffs? Can they be the first team to play a Super Bowl in their home stadium? That's something that we're excited to see about the Atlanta Falcons. I still do believe that they're a playoff team. And in this offseason, even though they didn't really make any big splashes in free agency because they needed to save their money for Matt Ryan, they did add a little bit of depth to the offensive line. They drafted, I think, relatively well. And I think they've improved. And they could be a playoff team. So maybe I'm a little bit biased because I'm a Falcons fan, but hey, you know, rise up. Carolina Panthers. So this is an interesting team. We talked about a team that improved in the Atlanta Falcons. With the Panthers, in some areas, I think they did improve, but in some areas, I think they're kind of lacking. And by lacking, I mean maybe in the secondary. And that all fell through when in free agency they attempted to sign Breshad Breeland, but he failed his physical and they couldn't sign him. So that was kind of hit in their secondary. But let's talk about the Panthers overall as a team. Signing CJ Anderson. So they let go of Jonathan Stewart. He's now in New York. He's going to be a good compliment to Saquon Barkley on third downs. CJ Anderson, what's his role going to be in Carolina after the Denver Broncos let him go? People are upset that, well, they signed CJ Anderson, so you're going to take the light away from Christian McCaffrey. You got to give Christian McCaffrey his moment. That's not the case, because Christian McCaffrey is a special player. He's not a player that's built to run the ball 25 carries a game on top of lining up in the slot and getting 6 to 7 receptions a game. He's not that kind of player. Instead, he'll get those 6 to 7 receptions a game and maybe 12 to 15 carries a game. 15, I'd be even surprised if he gets that many. CJ Anderson is going to be a good complement to him because he can be more of that workhorse kind of back when you need or when you have a goal line situation, a third and short kind of deal. Which I thought that they were fine if they just went with McCaffrey, Cameron, Artis Payne, also their fullback, Alex Arma. You know, so let me tell you a true legitimate story about Carolina Panthers fullback Alex Arma. So we actually lived in the same neighborhood growing up. I kid you not. He's from Decatur, Georgia, which is the city that I live in, that I grew up in. And we rode the bus together. And this was elementary school. I think he was a year younger than me. He doesn't know me really well. I don't even know if he still remembers me, but I still remember him, obviously, because he was a big-time football player coming out of that a small town like Decatur and going to West Georgia. But the story is that one time, I think I was in like fifth grade or so, he was in fourth, we were riding the bus, and we were riding the bus home after school. Bus was in our neighborhood trying to drop us off. Well, anyways, the kids were misbehaving on this bus. They were just talking. They were being loud. I don't know what else was going on, but the bus driver was just like, stop talking, stop being loud, whatever. Eventually, she couldn't calm us down. So what she did is that she pulled over. She actually pulled her bus over before we entered our neighborhood on the side of the road. And she said, y'all hush, otherwise we're just going to stay here. And nobody cared. I guess we're just a bunch of elementary school kids. We were immature. Nobody cared. We still talked. Well, anyways, what this woman does is that she turns around. She grabs her radio because bus drivers have radios. They can radio. I don't know who they radio. The superintendent. I don't know. Whatever. But she was radioing with someone. And then she said it escalated to the point where she was like, I have a code 4. I have a code 4 that's going on. And I kid you not, this legitimately happened. Carolina Panthers fullback Alex Arma, after she said that, he said, breaker, breaker, this is code 4. We don't give a damn. This is a 9-year-old kid that said that. And ever since that's actually the one story that I remember about Alex Arma. Out of all the football highlights that he put at Tequila High School, that is one of the more memorable stories that I remember about this kid. He doesn't remember that, I don't think. Maybe he does. I don't know. But that legitimately happened. I kid you not. It was the funniest thing ever. And that's the one thing I remember at him. But back to football. The Carolina Panthers overall, I think that they're a team that is still good. They're still playoff worthy. But I don't see a lot of improvement in them. I think that because of that, the NFL is an evolving game. You have to get better, or you have to change things every single year about your team. Otherwise, the other teams in the NFC are going to make a push for that wild card. So the Carolina Panthers, I think they're still a wild card team, but they have the possibility of missing out just because there are other NFC teams that were in that wild card position, such as the Green Bay Packers, who are going to get Aaron Rodgers back, that might push him out of that wild card race. But it's just one of those things that we're going to have to see. Patreon. So, listen, guys. Patreon is the number one way to pay your favorite content creator. Think of it like a GoFundMe. You sponsor someone. You choose how much money you put in each month. So, your content creators. It could be your favorite YouTuber, favorite artist, favorite Instagram model that has no talent. Whatever it is, you pay them every single month and they use your funds to help contribute to future projects about their brand, about their modeling gigs, about any videography projects that they have going on. For Time to Football, we are on Patreon. And if you sponsor Time to Football through Patreon, there are perks. You can contribute whether it be a $5 a month or even a dollar a month, something as little as that. And for our perks is if you do a dollar a month, you get a free Time to Football wristband. And if you do $5 a month, you get a free t-shirt. There are going to be more perks in the future, but for now, a dollar a month gets you a free wristband and $5 a month gets you a free t-shirt. If everyone listening to this podcast gave just $1 a month, we would have enough income to help grow Time to Football tremendously. I kid you not. Just $1. One person, $1. That's all we ask for. It's going to help us out a lot. Your money is used to fund future projects that we have planned for Time to Football, which you can read all the plans that we have on patreon.com/time2football. You can contribute to there. That's patreon.com/time2football. patreon.com/time2football. Every little bit helps. The Tampa Bay Buccaneers. So their biggest thing this offseason was that they stockpiled on draft picks. They traded up, they traded down. They were solid in picking their defensive tackle of the future, Vita Vea. And I think they had a pretty great draft just because they added a lot of depth to a team that needed it. One specific position was the running back position that I was actually looking forward to them helping out during this draft. And they really addressed it when they got Ronald Jones out of USC. Maybe not in his first year. He's going to be the workhorse back, but for years to come, he might be a good starting running back for them. And they also let Doug Martin go to the Oakland Raiders, which I honestly am a fan of. not Doug Martin to the Raiders, but the Buccaneers not having Doug Martin. So there was one game back in 2012 when Doug Martin rushed for 250-something yards and four touchdowns. And ever since that game, everybody's saying, man, sleeper running back for my fantasy football team, Doug Martin. And I said to that, nope, get the muscle hamster away from my fantasy football lineup, because I don't believe it. I don't believe the hype. Yes, he had a good game, and he's had good games since, but he hasn't been consistent. And I don't get the idea of, you know, people hold on to one big performance that someone's had in the past, back in 2012, and then they'll say in 2013, yeah, he'll have a good year. And then they'll say in 2014, oh, 2013 was just a down year, but he's still good because he had that one game in 2012, he's going to have a good year. 2015 comes along, and they say, oh, well, he had that one game in 2012 that was really good, so he's going to be good in 2015. He's still a good back. Same thing in 2016 and in 2017. I saw a trade in my fantasy football league that was centered around Doug Martin. I think it was Doug Martin and another player. Had to be someone irrelevant. It wasn't like a big-time player. Doug Martin and another player for Tyreek Hill. And I was like, man, don't give up Tyreek Hill. Not for Doug Martin. And it happened because people are still concerned about the hype or built around this idea. Well, he had 256 yards back 5 years ago. He can do it again. And it hasn't happened since then. So not a fan of Doug Martin. As for the Buccaneers, I still think they are a year away from a team that can make a wild card or even win the NFC South. For now, I still think that they'll be bordering around that 6-10 to 7-9 record. And I say that next year they might make it only if they were to keep Dirk Koetter. Not because I think Dirk Koetter is this amazing coach. I think he's a good coach, but not, you know, fantastic Bill Belichick type of coach. But he's just developed this kind of culture and this roster, and he's drafted players that fit his need. And if they keep Dirk Koetter around for one more year, I think they'll be in the playoffs in maybe not 2018, but in 2019. And the last team that we're going to talk about, the New Orleans Saints. And the big news coming out of the New Orleans Saints is that Mark Ingram is suspended for 4 days. Or not 4 days, sorry. That'd be fantastic if he was 4 days, right? But for four games. And that is a blow to them. But I think that the Saints, towards the last six games of the season last year, we're making it pretty apparent that Alvin Kamara is going to be the featured back. Mark Ingram is great. I think that he still deserves 20 to 25 touches a game because they worked well together, him and Kamara do. But man, 120 touches, 120 carries for Alvin Kamara last year. And he averaged 6.1 yards a carry. That is insane. For you fantasy football guys out there, Kamara could be a top five fantasy running back for the first 4 weeks, but for the rest of the season, he's a top 10. So I don't think he's going to leave the top 10 as far as production goes with running backs. But yeah, the Saints are making it apparent that Kamara is the guy. He is the guy of the future. As far as this suspension, what does it do for Mark Ingram's career? Is he going to be around in 2019? That, I don't know. That's looking ahead. But for the first 4 weeks, I think they'll be fine with just Alvin Kamara. We're talking about Georgia. Speaking of Georgia, he went to Norcross High School. I actually got to not see him play in a game live, but he was the sort of talk of the town. Here in Georgia, Norcross High School is in the same county, Gwinnett County, as in the high school that I went to, that Alex Arma went to, and actually Robert Kimdichie as well. That guy I got to see live, and that guy is one scary guy, Robert Kimdichie. He was a running back at 250 pounds. He was a big man. But as far as the Saints go, they are a playoff team. I think that their draft has helped them out a lot as well. And I think that Drew Brees, him signing a contract extension saying, hey, I'm going to be here for at least another year. I know I signed a 2-year contract extension, but I'm going to be here for another year because I still believe that we have this talent to go ahead and win a Super Bowl. I think it's going to be tough in the NFC South. It's one of the hardest divisions in the football. People are saying that, you know, if the Buccaneers do make a push, they could be that wild card team, the dark horse that people sleep on. But as far as the production level of the three, you know, consistent playoff teams, as in the Falcons, the Panthers, and the Saints, that's going to be a tough division to win. But I definitely want to hear your thoughts. What you guys think about the NFC South? Who's going to win that division? If I had to pick a division winner, that's going to be tough. You know, I'm going to go with the Atlanta Falcons, partly because I am biased and they are my favorite team. But man, they are one of those teams that, one of the few teams in the NFL that they were good last year and they didn't get worse. They can only get better. And when I say that they were good, people are gonna hate on their offense and say that it was inconsistent, it was unproductive. At times, it was just situational play calling, just dumb decisions that they got to get over. As far as production goes, they were 8th in the NFL in passing. They're 13th in rushing. And I only think those numbers are going to go up. Now that they're in sync with Sarkisian, they were 10-6, made the divisional round of the playoffs. They beat the Rams. Granted, the Rams are better this year, but they were a solid team last year. And they have nowhere to go but up. And I really like the Falcons to take this division and give a strong push towards Super Bowl 53 that will be played in their home stadium. I like the Atlanta Falcons to win. What do you guys think? I would definitely love to hear from you guys. You can hit me up on Instagram. That's probably the outlet that we are the most active on. If you go to Instagram and search for Time to Football, you'll find us. You'll find our logo. You'll find us. The username is just Time to Football. Definitely let us know in the comments. Send us a message. Even if you have questions that you want answered on this podcast, definitely let me know. Send me a message. I respond. So search Time to Football on Instagram. That's our way of communicating. But you can also go to YouTube. If you're not listening to this on YouTube, you're listening to this on iTunes, you can go to youtube.com/timetofootball. So go to YouTube, search Time to Football. Subscribe to us on there, but also when you subscribe, hit that little bell icon right next to the subscribe button, because what that does, it gets you a notification every time a new video comes out. And if you're watching this on YouTube, don't know we have a podcast, go to the podcast app on your phone and search for Time of Football and subscribe. Not only that, rate and review this podcast. I'm telling you, that's going to help us out a lot. If we get a lot of people but rating and reviewing this, telling us their feedback, whether they liked it, whether they hate it, we can improve on that. Whether it's, hey, Hassan, you have a disgusting voice and I don't want to hear from you again. Okay, I'll get someone else on the podcast to help me out. Maybe it could be you, because one day we would love to get our listeners on here as well. But definitely make sure to rate and review. So thanks again, and don't make fun of the way Trevor Lawrence looks, okay? Be nice. I think he's a very talented football player. Breaker, breaker, this is code 4. We don't give a damn. Oh my gosh. Man, that was, I would never forget that moment.